Muted. Hello, can you hear me?
Yep, we hear you again. So it's off to you. We have quorum. We've got six people.
Few slides, please, and take us to the agenda. Great. Okay, so today we'll have a presentation, but I want to talk a bit about the working groups before that. If you go to the next slide, please. So we've had five people vote for the safe/security working group. I'm not really somebody who feels very comfortable talking about security, which is one of the reasons I haven't voted, although I think something like this is needed. Is there somebody else who's on the call today who has a TOC vote who would like to be the sixth vote or at least say clearly what they're concerned about that we need to finish to get this over the line?
I'd say I've not voted. I generally have concerns about working groups and what they're trying to achieve and what they have achieved and what our mechanisms for oversight are. And since there have been a number of cases where disagreements have started in working groups, whether I question whether we have enough community management to really properly manage an expanding number of working groups. So like other than the serverless working group, which I reviewed the white paper, it's not clear to me what the other working groups are doing. You know, we have occasional brief updates, but I don't feel like they've been that reflective of like what value they're actually providing to us.
Okay. Does anyone else want to add to that? We've got this. This will be a good topic. This is a good segue into the next topic, actually, about generally categories and working groups. Does anyone else want to say anything? Brian Cantrell, were you online?
Yeah, and I was, I mean, I share those concerns. I think the thing that I also get concerned about is that it's unclear what authority we are vesting in these working groups. And I just become concerned when people feel that they've got more authority than they might have. Either people on the working group or people not in the working group are vesting this with more authority than we are kind of perceiving. So I've got all the same concerns.
Yeah, that has definitely come up in the past.
Right. I mean, those would be things that we would absolutely need to get more clarity on, especially if we're going to be creating more different sort of subgroups within the CNCF. Those subgroups will need to have some degree of responsibility and accountability in order to function well. And I think we also, as we saw recently with cloud events, we'd like to have more clarity around the projects that are coming out of the working groups as well, and what their role is and the expectations around that. So we could try and discuss that today, or we could try and work it out offline. Brian, what would your preference be? I don't feel comfortable asking you to vote if you have these doubts, and I'm not going to vote until, you know, we've got a bit more clarity. So what would you like to do? Do you want to, should we carve out a working session on this and try and plan it out, or is it a face-to-face topic? What do you think?
Yeah, I think planning some meeting time to discuss this so we can prepare ahead of time, and the people who have been more involved with some of the working groups can bring to the rest of the TOC what they feel the value is that the working groups are delivering, and, you know, have an opportunity to address the concerns or propose changes to how we provide oversight or don't to the working groups and things like that. I don't know if we have all of the working group sponsors on today.
I don't see Ben, but I think Ken is on for networking.
I'm on.
And Quentin is not on. Are you on, Quentin? No. Okay.
Yeah, Ken and Camille are on, I guess. You know, the working groups have charters that are fairly broad and vague in general, and this one is no different. And it's, I'd be more comfortable with like more specific goals. I don't know if we just plan for these groups to exist forever. You know, as we expand the scope of the CNCF, fracturing into sub areas or something like that, I think that's worth figuring out. But I don't really feel like I have, you know, other than the one white paper that was produced and the cloud events project that came out with the serverless working group, it's not really clear to me what the other working groups that are really providing to us.
And I think we have had some examples where the working groups have churned more than we would like, where it feels less productive than I think they would like or we would like.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Well, those definitely tie into the next topic. So let me take you through that, because I think that would be useful. So let's go over to the next slide, please. Let's just skip this slide, please. Project presentations, go check them out. Let's skip the next slide, please. Okay. So this is the categories topic, which kind of overlaps with working groups. And this was trying to figure out a way to make the CNCF project universe a little bit more manageable, a bit clearer, to have more focused efforts around sub areas. I talked about this a couple of meetings ago, and there was some good feedback on it. This is a very, very slightly tightened up proposal. It's not a full written out document, and I do think we need that, but I wanted to offer this as a sort of another update and try and figure out how we're going to break this off and make it work. Because I think if we don't do something like this, we're just going to end up with a massive sprawl of projects ranging from large down to small. So the proposal is to have a concept of a category. And a typical category might be observability or security, or it could even be for a very large project such as Kubernetes, it could be its own category, and it could have affiliated projects around it in the same category. And then the things that would be associated with that category could include, a landing page on the CNCF website, which describes the category, what's in it, what it's for, a supporting white paper along the lines of the serverless white paper, and a supporting landscape along the lines of the serverless landscape. Then the second point is a mechanism for essentially federating the TOC. So what could that look like? Number one, the sandbox projects that are in a specific category, when they get regularly reviewed, could be reviewed within that category, because I think that that would create greater focus, and it would also save the TOC from doing a lot of that kind of work, and then have a quarterly and annual check-in with the TOC. So just as a straw man, I've suggested a quarterly check-in could be a 15-minute presentation from the working group running the category, and then an annual check-in might actually have a more formal structure with a document of what we've done this year and what we'd like to do next. Ducey, the answer to your question is yes, on the next slide. Another thing that might happen is we could delegate some of the work supporting technical marketing to the category leads and the members of the category. So user guides, talking to analysts, talking to other people. I don't know if this is a good or bad idea, but I do think there is work to be done here that could be done in a different way.
So Alexis, can I ask, what's the problem we're trying to solve here?
Well, I'm worried that we're just going to have a ton of projects and the TOC is going to be completely overwhelmed.
Okay, which is fair. Maybe it's worth exploring that a little bit and what some other alternatives are, because I've got a lot of concerns with, you've got domains where you've got a couple of different approaches where there's been a lot of more heat than light, I think, in some of the public discussions anyway on some of these issues. And I would be very concerned that we would be recreating some of the problems we saw where the working group model didn't work, where you effectively have you've got a battlefield for belligerence without any sort of control or oversight. And everyone believing that they are fighting, that they need to fight a battle to the death because that working group will decide the future of that particular domain. And I don't know that that's going to be productive. And I think it's definitely contrary to what we want to avoid being kingmakers. And I'm concerned that if we federate ourselves, we are effectively saying that, well, the job of kingmaking is so exhausting, we're going to delegate the kingmaking out, which is to me a recipe for this kind of federated conflict.
I think that those are all good points. The TOC should remain the decision maker on project acceptance and fundamental graduation issues. But I think there is a benefit to, you know, trying to channel desire to contribute from the community into productive areas. Otherwise, the TOC could become a bottleneck. So the question is, you know, what are the things that are really important for the TOC to do and be as objective and fair about as possible and try and be vendor neutral about? And what are the areas where, we allow for the fact that contributors who volunteer may have some kind of agenda?
So one thing that would be helpful would be to have some of these domains kind of operate as investigative staff does in a legislative body, where they are they're tasked with actually the findings of fact to actually set the landscape and help inform decisions that we might make, where they're not trying to, they're just trying to say, I'm not trying to say which approach is best, but here are the five different approaches that are out there in the observability world, say. And maybe talk about the trade-offs that each is making in their own words. That I think would be helpful. My concern, observability in particular, maybe I've been spending too much time on Twitter, which is almost certainly the case, but I just feel like that's a good example of where there's been a lot of just fierce combat from people who should otherwise agree about the abstract problem they're trying to solve, but they happen to work for different companies. So they're just at one another's throats. And I really, really don't want to create a venue for that under the CNCF banner.
I don't want to have the CNCF be a lightning rod for people's anxieties about the success or failure of their company or project either. That would be very demoralizing. But you know, what are the, Brian, what do you think are the good aspects of this proposal? I mean, you mentioned the investigative groups in the US legislative system. What else would you think is important here? Because this obviously touches on, it's a role for the work, trying to formalize what working groups actually do around these areas more concretely.
Yeah, and I think it would be helpful. I mean, and if we can find some way to help inform the TOC, because obviously we're not domain experts in everything by a long shot. And there are a lot of these areas where there are kind of subtly different approaches that vehemently disagree with one another. And it's hard for us to figure out what's actually going on. And it would be very, very helpful to have some documents that help inform that. And I guess my question is, I think it's a good problem to solve. How can we solve that problem without creating additional ones, I guess, is the challenge. I don't necessarily have an answer. I think it's tough.
Okay.
Well, I think if we create a bunch of subgroups, one thing that's definitely going to be required is actual active community management to keep the peace. And to, you know, someone mentioned, isn't that what we have code of conduct for? Unless you have people who are very skilled with how to deal with these kind of interpersonal issues and inter-vendor arguments and disputes, things can escalate very quickly. Despite some people's good intentions, you know, engineers and whatnot aren't necessarily the best people to do this, especially if they're involved in the heated technical discussions. You really need to have people who are, that's their role to do that. And we've definitely seen this explode in a few instances in the past. So I also share that concern. You know, to answer the question of what could be good about this, you know, I do think we need some more structure. I'm not super happy with us just reviewing projects as they express interest. I feel like we need to get more proactive, and we are bandwidth constrained. So if we could say, look, we aren't going to accept any new projects in this area until we have like a landscape overview, and we actually understand what the significant projects are in that space. And then we will ask them all to present, and we will decide which ones are a fit and which ones are not a fit according to, you know, our various principles and other criteria. I think if we don't do that, we're just gonna.
I just don't see how we like scale this. The straw man list of categories is so many categories, and it's already a ton of work. I mean, frankly, it's already like a reasonable amount of work doing TOC calls, looking at projects, voting, you know, kind of keeping an eye on things, adding active working group, commitments is like, at this point, I feel like we are not scaling the TOC very well. I don't know if my fellow TOC members feel that way, but you know, I think some of like, obviously each of us has a bit different ability to commit time to this process, but you know, the more fine grained we break things down, it's useful in certain ways, but like we just can't expect that there's going to be a TOC member who's going to be, you know, in it for each one of these different categories and like, you know, trying to mediate and provide advice to the other TOC members. Like it's just not scaling, I don't think. And I think that's a big problem that we're seeing right now with the org. I'm not sure that breaking this down in categories is not a bad idea if we can figure out how do we then make that so that delegates can do the work and not have it be TOC members, but it will be political if we do that, period, end of story. I mean, the fact that Brian suggested that this is like, you know, legislative analysis, it's like, yes, and guess who's influencing them? It's like the lobbyists are all over the place. So,
you know. It's a totally fair point. Yeah, that's a totally fair point. I think that, and I think I totally agree, Camille, that we don't have the time or bandwidth to do this. And I also feel like adjudicating between two rival startups is something I've got zero interest in. Even if it's a domain in which I've got expertise, maybe especially if it's a domain in which I've got expertise. I think that part of the problem is that we have implicitly been tasked with too much, in that there are too many people who believe that the being a CNCF project means more than I think we think it should mean. And as a result, they have created this kind of very high stakes kind of interaction that I don't think we want. I mean, I think that's part of the concern that I have, is that we are under siege, in part because of the popularity of Kubernetes, which is great, and the popularity of a lot of these technologies. But the flip side of that is that everyone believes that being a five pixel high icon on a landscape website is going to make or break them, which of course it won't. But it's very hard to prevail when that belief is so strongly set.
This is Luis from Portworks. I think the main issue is that customers are making decisions due to those rankings.
Yeah, they're not. They're really not. Sorry,
no,
that's why. But no, maybe it's about you raising your next round. But customers are.
No, there's no reason about it. I'm not in that. I'm an engineer, but I'm just saying that we have seen customers make decisions because they say this project is part of CNCF. They're very clear about that.
Well, you know, Brian, I have to add one up on that. Is that I also think there are plenty of people at big companies that are saying my next promo is based on me getting my project.
Oh God, it's even worse.
Yeah, I am 100% sure that is happening.
I'm sure you're right.
Some of our sandbox projects, right? So we've got a project explosion on our hands that's coming from, you know, from startups who believe that this is a competitive advantage, from people at big companies who are trying to, you know, get their staff engineer, senior staff engineer approved, whatever.
So we are literally standing between them and their bonus, which is not where we want to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, but how do we change that perception? I don't think adding a blurb to the website, having some disclaimer saying, hey, even though this is on here, don't make your decisions based on that, is not going to cut it. So, I mean, I have to agree with Camille from a year, just the number of projects trying to really do a technical analysis of that, it's impossible, at least coming from me, like wanting to really look deeply into each one of these projects, that's not scaling. So I mean, how do we change the culture of what that means? And then how do we get enough coverage on these so that if these are as high as stakes as people are putting in there, regardless of what we say, are we actually doing enough due diligence for each one of these? And personally, I'm only going to speak for myself. I don't feel like I'm doing a good job at that.
I mean, we're doing quite a bit of DD for incubation, and we've deliberately lowered the bar for sandbox.
Right.
You know, one of the benefits of the categories is to kind of push the sandboxes over to under each category. So it's kind of even more out of the way. You're just in the sandbox for some particular category. But I was hoping this that we could, for example, you know, whether it's three categories or 10, whoever's associated with managing that category, which should, I hope, be more of a community thing, could come to the TOC periodically with an overview of what's going on, so that the TOC's interaction with a lot of this noise could come through that signal. And of course, that then creates the potential for politics, but I can't see another way of doing it without just increasing the number of voting members of the TOC, which brings another set of issues.
I don't think that we've successfully distinguished the sandbox from incubation for most people. I just looked through some press articles this morning, and most of them, none of them mention sandbox in the headline, and many of them don't even mention it in the article, or if they do, they certainly don't explain it. So I think the sandbox projects are still getting more publicity than is warranted, you know, based on our press releases. And, you know, we talked about, well, how do we lower the stakes? I think as we accept more projects, I am starting to hear CNCF will take anything now from people, which, again, because they don't distinguish sandbox from the other projects, I don't think that's what we want either. So I don't know how we can more strongly brand the sandbox projects differently, but we're not succeeding in that right now.
Right. Okay. I don't think we're going to reach a conclusion today, so I'm going to call a halt to this part of the discussion, but I think this has been a good airing of the issue. And I do think it's very much around scalability, politics. Can we go to the next slide, please? That was just basically parsing of the landscape into some buckets. And then go to the next slide, please.
Wait, I have a question about the buckets. And we have some buckets on the trail map and in the reference architecture. Do these don't look like they exactly line up with those?
No, this is based on the landscape rather than the trail map. I'm happy to use any other bucketing. This was just a straw man.
Okay.
I have no emotional commitment to this mapping whatsoever.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so let's move on to the presentation because we've got 30 minutes left. Net data. Okay, do we have a speaker on from Net Data, please?
Yes, here I am.
Hi. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. So guys, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present you the data. Let's go to the first slide immediately. I would like to give you a brief overview of the motivation behind the data, why people love it, why we did it. So I used to work for the last 10 years for a fintech company, you know, financial transactions, acquiring, issuing, etc. And we had a very simple SLA. 90% of the transactions have to be completed within 1 second. And the maximum duration for any successful transaction is 5 seconds. We had an infrastructure, a large infrastructure based on Hadoop and Time TSDB and you know, all this kind of Apache ecosystem, bundled with several commercial services. Everything was hosted on Azure, etc. The problem was that we had a clear indication of when transactions failed to meet the SLA. But after that, we had nothing. So at the end of the day, we were forced to run console tools all over the place, almost permanently, to be able to troubleshoot performance issues. Then we started developing this tool, Nedata. Nedata was initially a very small data collector. It collected metrics of high resolution per second and had a memory cache. It was able to visualize them using Google charts and the likes. Immediately we understood that people, you know, most of the companies consider having a time series database where people can query it and do stuff like that. We immediately figured out that this does not work. Why? Because people do not understand the metrics. They don't know the metrics. So a developer is capable of understanding his own metrics, the metrics of the application, but after that, he knows almost nothing. He needs the expertise of sysadmins, of network admins, of DBAs, etc. So we understood that we need, of course, we needed more metrics in order to find correlations between them, but we also understood that we need a different visualization, a visualization that could provide insights on the correlation of the metrics and how they relate to each other. Let's go to the next slide. So as time passed, we added more data collection mechanisms. We use everywhere, we use the most efficient way, resource efficient way. So we want this thing to be very fast, very, very thin, and very resource efficient. We changed the database, the format of the database, so instead of working on a bunch of metrics, you know, most times these databases work on a bunch of metrics. The data is something different because in the database there is the meaning of the metrics. Each metric has units, has calculations to convert the units. It is correlated with other metrics in charts. Charts are in families. Families are in applications, etc. So the idea is that we wanted to give the users something they can browse immediately without knowing anything prior to that. And then we wanted to be open, embeddable, and degradable, so not to introduce another engine, another, you know, ecosystem in the enterprise. Let's go to the next one. So what is NetData today? NetData is a data collection agent. You install it on your machines. It has a round-robin database. So it's a cache for a few hours, let's say. The data collection, everything is real-time. Everything happens per second. It can stream metrics between a data server. So you can have a headless NetData collector and then a master server or a proxy server that collects and restreams the metrics, receives and retransmits the metrics. It can archive its metrics to time series databases like Prometheus, like Graphite, OpenTSDB, etc. It has embedded a health monitoring watchdog. So this watchdog has statistical algorithms and can support rolling windows and all this kind of stuff in order to evaluate alarms, to generate health monitoring events. It can dispatch these events, of course, and then API. The API is pretty simple. It is 5 calls, all of it. But then we built on top of this API a visualization engine as a static web page, as a static web app. So it's just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that queries the API and presents the whole dashboard. Let's go to the next, please. So that's the history. We released it March 2016, 2.5 years ago. Today, that's all the history of what we built through these 2 years. Today, we have 32,000 GitHub stars, about 1 million unique users, about 500,000 unique nodes monitored, 24 actually is today Docker pools, 24 million Docker pools, a lot of contributors. And the community is growing by 2,000 new unique users per day and 1,000 new nodes monitored. Next one, please. So collecting metrics at per second is tough. Here is a chart. The animated chart is of a busy, let's say, cloud environment, a cloud VM, where you can see that latency, data collection latency on proc file system reaches even 100 milliseconds randomly. This is a problem because this introduces about 10% error randomly on the data we collect. NetData does this right, so it collects, it measures the latency for each for each file, proc file separately, so that the interpolated data are always accurate at the end. Let's go to the next one, please. So data collection, metadata supports internal plugins and external plugins. Internal plugins are written in C, so they are threads inside the data. External plugins are in any language you like. Of course, we wanted to simplify things, so we support data collection orchestrators. The main orchestrator is written in Python. We will see later it has a lot of modules, but we support all other languages too. Let's go to the next. These are data collection slides, just to give you a brief overview of what metadata does. It collects a lot of information from proc. Let's go to the next one. It collects, this is nice because it collects containers via C groups, control groups. So it is able to, from the host, to collect information, resource utilization metrics for containers for any, of any orchestrator, of any manager or container manager. So it supports, as a side effect, it supports also VMs, libvirt QEMU VMs, and systemd services. Two things are missing from cgroups. One is the networks that are attached to each container. For this thing, it queries the network stack of the system to find out the network interfaces that are attached to each container. And it also has another helper that queries the Docker or Kubernetes or whatever to find out the name of the container. Let's go to the next one. It has an internal StatsD server, StatsD plugin. So it is a high speed StatsD server. And because metadata is distributed, it is installed all over the place. This means that all applications are sending StatsD metrics to localhost, which is faster and more, it follows the availability of the server, let's say. Because we require from the metrics to have some meaning, some metadata attached to them, we support synthetic charts. So although the StatsD protocol supports just a bunch of metrics, with synthetic charts, you can have patterns to assign the charts, the metrics in charts and applications and families, etc. Let's go to the next one. So more plugins. Netfilter, DiskSpace, quality of service, enterprise hardware IPMI. It runs on FreeBSD, on macOS. Let's go to the next one. The interesting one are near the end, so I am trying to go fast. So this is apps plugin is very, very important because it processes the whole process tree every second, all of it, even the it is inside the containers from the host. So unlike all the other tools we have seen so far, this has a unique feature. This can break down the total CPU utilization of the system to the processes running. It does this by using also the utilization, the usage of the exit children of processes. So if you have a shell script that spawns hundreds of commands per second, each command for a few milliseconds, this plugin can correctly allocate the total CPU utilization, not only CPU, all the CPU, even disk, even whatever, the total resource utilization of the shell script to that process. Let's go to the next one. This is the Python plugin. Okay, we collect databases, we collect web servers, we collect queue engines, many plugins. Three are of special interest. Is the web log plugin that takes access logs, web server log files, or proxy log files, and turn them into real-time metrics. HTTP check does remote HTTP and HTTP checks on local host or remote web servers, and port check examines remote TCP connections, remote TCP listeners. okay, these are written in Python. Actually, I think we have reached the limit with Python. Python is not so, due to its logs, it has some issues when too many things are running in parallel. So we are moving almost everything to Go. Let's go to the next one, please. Node plugin, we have also implemented an SNMP collector there. We have a bus plugin for someone that wants to quickly do stuff with a few commands, collect metrics with a few commands, and an FPIC plugin that collects latency, jitter, and packet loss over remote endpoints. Let's go to the next one. So metric streaming, each net data can run in these modes, so it can be an autonomous monitoring, the default installation. It can be a headless collector, a headless proxy. When we say headless, we mean that the data does not listen to an API. The API does not exist, is not there. There is no database, there is nothing. So autonomous monitoring, headless collector, headless proxy, store and forward proxy. So this proxy can also expose the metrics via the API, and the master that collects everything together. This allows the whole setup is the whole idea is to build hierarchies of net data. The images on the right, you can see on the top image a setup with ephemeral nodes that push all metrics to a net data master, and this one visualizes and does everything for the ephemeral nodes. And on the lower right, you can see a setup with three teams, where two teams are responsible for a part of the network, part of the infrastructure, and the third team has full visibility on everything. Let's go to the next one. Metrics archiving. So NetData can send all the metrics it collects to all these formats, to these backend databases, time series databases. It can send them in two formats. As collected is what we normally do with all other collectors. So it does not process them. It does not interpolate them. It does not do anything on them. It just receives them, collects them, and sends them to the time series database. And the average is where it exports the metrics through each database. So these are interpolated metrics. Everything is Gauss and presentation ready with the right units, I mean. NetData can also, because it collects thousands of metrics per node, the typical setup is about 2,000 metrics per server or per container, let's say. Everything is per second. So in order not to overflow these time series databases, it can lower the frequency it pushes metrics. Let's go to the next one. Health monitoring. Health monitoring is an independent thread within a data. It is lockless, so it's actually a watchdog. It supports statistical algorithms and rolling windows and the likes. It supports also alarm templates, so you can say, okay, I want this to happen for all my network interfaces, all my disks, or all my MySQL servers, or all my containers. So it's templatized, and there is a mechanism for sending notifications to all this. Actually, a lot of Slack and mails and web notifications and all this kind of stuff. Let's go to the next one. Now, what I didn't tell you about the health monitoring is that the data comes with hundreds of alarms pre-configured. So you just install it, and immediately it will tell you if detects any anomaly on your system. Meaningful presentation. As I said, meaningful presentation was very important because most people do not understand the metrics. They don't have a clue what the metrics mean. So what we did is that out of the box, you get a presentation like that. Everything is very well organized. You can see on the right of the slide the main menu, menu of a dashboard. Let's go to the next one. The page, the dashboards NetData provides are optimized for anomaly detection. We have done a lot of work for that. So you can see, for example, that you can mark an area, and once you mark it, all the other charts are marked. All the charts are like one. So you do something on one chart, it happens on all charts. There is no point to go one by one. Let's go to the next one. You can see all this on the if you navigate the dashboard. Snapshots is a nice feature when you want to open a ticket. For example, we had to open tickets to hosting providers or vendors somehow, and we wanted to share the metrics with them. So what Metadata does, it allows you to save a snapshot. The snapshot is a download including everything the dashboard includes for the visible time frame. So you just pan and zoom the charts to the time frame you like. You press a button, a snapshot is saved. It's a file on your disk. This can be shared to third parties attached to incident support tickets. When loaded back, you get exactly the same view you had when you saved it, with all the data at the desired resolution. And these actually, the snapshots are not uploaded to a server. This is just a web browser feature. So the data are loaded on any Netdata server on your browser. So you go to a Netdata server, you say import the snapshot, and it loads it, even if it comes from another server. Let's go to the next one. Embeddable visualization. Embeddable visualization allows Netdata to integrate its visualization, its charts, on any third-party app. It's any web page, actually. Here you see four web servers coming from all over the world to a Confluence page. This is funny because, you know, when we developed that on the company I worked for, we had a team, the QA team, that had all the errors. They had collected all the errors that could happen for a transaction. They put it on a page, on a Confluence page, for a table, let's say. Then the DevOps guys saw that page and say, okay, I can add charts for all this. For each of these errors, I can add a chart. And they did it. They added a sparkline chart just in the table. Then the operations guy saw that and said, okay, look, this happened, should not happen. This error should not happen. I can talk to the banks and try to solve them. Suddenly, they started attaching Jira tickets on that with the communication we had with the banks. So three different teams, out of nowhere, in a few days, they managed to build a very powerful tool to examine and troubleshoot and scrutinize all the errors the infrastructure had. It was very nice. Very, I loved it. Okay, let's go to the next one. I find it magical. So let's say comparison. This is what a typical setup. A user run a number of nodes. It needs health check, automatic health checks and alarm notifications, and wants to have a visual review of the performance of their systems and applications. Let's go to the next one. So the traditional model is that, okay, you will have a number of data collectors on each of your nodes. Usually you need many. Then you will have all these data collectors will have to push the metrics in real time to a time series database. But because this database is a bottleneck, it needs resources, you have to cherry pick the metrics and, don't push them too frequently. Try to be gentle with that, because that will be expensive at the end to do it at full resolution. This database somehow, either with a third-party engine, will send alarms. Most probably, you will have to build each alarm one by one. And to visualize the data, you will have to learn a query language and learn a visualization tool to have some dashboards. But at the end, these dashboards are usually too poor for real-time performance monitoring, troubleshooting. So yes, of course, they give you an overview, but most probably are not good enough for visual anomaly detection and for troubleshooting the underlying performance issues. Let's go to the next one. This is the simplest model, the simplest form of any data. So you have what you have, just install the data on it. This is it. Every node is autonomous. If you want a time, if you have a time series database, you can put it there. You can stream your metrics. You immediately will receive health notifications, and you will have real-time interactive automated dashboards that visualize every single metric, and which are perfect for visual anomaly detection. And of course, you will not have to learn a query language for that. So no additional resources. Let's go to the next one. This one is a setup with ephemeral nodes. With ephemeral nodes, you know, you don't know the URL of the server. Where is the server to connect to? So in this case, what we do is that we install the collector at the master node of Kubernetes, let's say, or somewhere that the ephemeral nodes with the same configuration, all the ephemeral nodes can push metrics in real time. The permanent node in this case, the data is self-cleaning, so it knows if it spawns, if hundreds of ephemeral nodes have been spawned, to clean up after some time, you define all this kind of stuff, etc. Again, this is a lot more cost effective. You actually get real-time performance troubleshooting and visual anomaly detection for no additional cost. Let's go to the next one. So the bottom line of the NODA today is that we believe changes the economics of monitoring. It uses only available resources. We never require dedicated resources from users. It requires minimal human skills. You just install it, all the expertise and all the knowledge is embedded in it. So it will guide you, it will drive you. And we have automated everything that can be automated. Of course, there is a lot more work to do. In contrast with other solutions, NetData has been designed for sysadmins, DevOps, and developers. So it's not a data scientist tool. It's not something a data scientist can query and do stuff. And the idea is to have a tool that will improve the operations immediately. You just install it, immediate results. Let's go to the next one. This is what we have in on our roadmap. We want to improve the internal metrics database. Today, we need 2.2 bytes per point. We believe we can go below one. We need a new streaming, an improvement of the streaming protocol to support active clusters. Today, NetData supports active passive clusters only. And improve it in the cases of IoT, that the network is not reliable. To integrate it with service discovery tools, port it to Windows, have automated anomaly detection on it, support annotations, and many, many dashboard improvements. We can build, we want to build custom dashboards editors directly on this on this setup. So you just point and click and nothing to be learned above that. Let's go to the next one. So NetData in the CNCF ecosystem, we believe that NetData is a smarter data collector. It's a superset of most other data collectors. It provides high resolution metrics. It is lightweight. The things we said. So we strongly believe that NetData can be used in the, it will be useful in the whole CNCF observability ecosystem, providing real-time troubleshooting. And simplifying, we believe it simplifies a lot data collection. Let's go to the next one. Today it is GPL v3. We have created a company. We have moved all our copyright ownership to this company, all the contributors. So today 99% of the data of NetData is owned by NetData Inc. We will collect the rest 1% and then we can change the license to Apache 2.0. So that this was the presentation. What we want from CNCF is mainly everything your service desk says, everything. I mean, we need help in all areas to go through. So that's it.
Thank you. We're very low on time, but a couple of minutes for questions. I'll start. You mentioned that it does ephemeral systems. Have you got any examples where you're managing Kubernetes specifically and the kind of container microservice environments that epitomize cloud native?
Yes, the whole idea is that you install in a data, it's very simple, you install in a data on the hosts of all Kubernetes nodes, not in the containers, at the hosts. So once you do this, then even the ephemeral ones, then you can have a data stream metrics with static configuration to whatever your master is. Do you want me a demo? Do you want a demo of this setup? We can arrange that.
Anyone else got a question?
It seems, how many nodes do people typically monitor with net data? And, I mean, obviously there are many nodes being monitored with net data, but how many do people, tend to monitor in the hundreds and thousands or in the tens and hundreds?
Well, I can't answer that. I don't know. I know that there are a lot of people that collect, actually, because the data is distributed, you install it on all your servers. It doesn't influence the server. It needs just 1% CPU utilization of a single core. So it's ignorable. It does nothing on the server. Once you do that, then when you want to, you will immediately get alerts. So alerts is something you will get whatever you are with the channels you like. But at the same time, if the server gives you an alert, it will also send you a link to connect to that server and see what's happening, what's happening there. The whole idea is that the data is not, it scales infinitely because we are not requiring the metrics to be centralized. The metrics are kept inside the servers. Of course, you can centralize them if you want longer history than, 24 hours, but this is not required. So you can just install the data in hundreds of thousands of servers and nothing will happen. No, it will have no impact on anything. Is that clear?
Yep, thank you.
Okay, we're out of time. Thank you very much, Costa, for the presentation. And thank you, Matt, I just saw that you posted about the early discussion on the TOC list. Please, I want to solicit feedback on this topic of categories, scalability, politics, working groups. It's very clear that if the CNCF is to grow sustainably, we need a solution to the fact that there are only 9 TOC members, and Camille is not the only one of us who is time poor. I think we are all time poor, and we need to come up with a good solution that goes beyond what we've done so far. So thank you very much, everybody. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.